conservation of momentum essentially is force balance, okay. And just as we wrote, energy in, energy out, energy generated equal to energy stored. Similarly, we are going to write in this way also, rate at which momentum is coming in, rate at which momentum is going out, rate at which momentum is generated is equal to rate of change of momentum associated with that control volume. But Newton's law tells me we will call it by a different name, it is balanced by summation of all the forces. So, instead of me saying rate of change of momentum of the control volume, Newton's law says F is equal to ma, that is nothing but summation of all forces. So, a force balance is basically what we are doing, we are doing a force balance and equating it to momentum coming in, momentum coming out and momentum generated, okay. So, capital M in minus capital M out plus momentum generated equal to whatever is the balance of the forces. So, we will first do the left hand side. This integral that you see is nothing but, can anybody interpret this for me? Rho, there is a V in front, deliberately I have not told that, V, rho V dot n cap dA. What is that? What is, so rho V dot n cap dA, and there is a V here, and this is integrated over the CS. What is this integral? When you look at this integral, what do you understand? Is this a surface integral? Surface. How do we know? By this symbol and dA. Okay, we know that it is a surface integral. What is, I will look at it this way, rho V dot n cap dA. What is rho V dot n cap dA? So, essentially what this is telling me is m mass flow, what is V dot n vector? So, in fact, the governing equation for mass conservation was just integral rho V dot n cap dA, and that when it is evaluated over the surface becomes a negative sign for mass going in and a positive sign for mass coming out, because the velocity vector and the outward normal are in the same physical same direction outward for mass flow coming out, and it is in the opposite direction for the dot product when mass is going in. That is why this summation becomes a positive and a negative term, which we write as m dot in minus m dot out or whatever way you want to write, equal to 0. So, same thing here, the V times the associated mass flow rate. So, this quantity is a vector quantity, okay. So, V times the mass flow rate associated with that direction. So, we are going to write this as, what are the momentum which is going to come in, go out for each of the control surfaces. So, this is the control volume, control surfaces are these shaded, I mean unshaded rectangles which are there. So, rho dy dz is the area of this surface, u is the x component of the velocity v bar through this surface, that is the mass flowing through that surface. That mass carries a momentum in the x direction, which is given by product with u, okay. So, that is the momentum entering through this surface, momentum leaving through the corresponding phase at a distance dx from it is nothing but what is given by our Taylor series expansion. So, u rho u delta x delta y delta z plus d by dx of this whole bracket, which I am just going to write as rho u square for the derivative, because delta x delta y delta z is just the volume. I will write the same terms for the y direction, same terms for the z direction. What am I doing here? Go ahead.
I have a question. How did I write this y? Perhaps you two are thinking same thing. How did I write this term? U into rho v delta x delta z. Is that right? What am I doing there? Momentum in the x direction. So what am I multiplying with what? Mass flow rate in the y direction is multiplied with the velocity in the x direction. Because why are we doing this? Because we are deriving, what are we deriving? X momentum. So we are bookkeeping the x momentum in all directions. That is the reason why we are writing it like that. Okay.
These arrows are indicative of the mass flow rates direction. The u which is multiplying each of these terms. So there is a u here, u here, u here, everything. That will signify that it is the x momentum equation, x component of the momentum. Okay. So what this means, I was going to ask and sir himself asked. So this is the mass flow through this control surface multiplied by the x component of the velocity which is contributing to the x momentum equation. Corresponding term of going out, same thing for the z direction, rho dx dy times w which represents the mass flow rate in the z direction multiplied by the u that is the x component of the velocity which is the momentum transported, the corresponding term for the outward. So this when I write it is going to just become next slide. So when I do this budget I would get the first term here, here, here will cancel off with these three terms and I would be left with d by dx of rho u square plus d by dy of rho u v plus d by dz of rho u w whole thing multiplied by delta x delta y delta z. Okay. So what we have done is essentially we have opened that up, this is what it is. Okay. So this can now be expanded as u times d rho by dt plus d by dx of rho u. I am keeping the product rho u. In the second bracket, in the third term, I am taking u as one term and rho v as the second term and keeping that together. So, u times d by dy of rho v plus u times d by dz it should be of rho w. Okay, this should be a dz here. Plus, now I will take the other term of the first term here, that is rho times du by dt plus rho u was here. So, rho u comes out. So, rho times u du by dx plus rho times v du by dy plus rho times w du by dz. This essentially if you look at this is your continuity equation. So, this whole thing goes to 0, the first big bracket goes to 0 and I am left with rho du by dt plus u du by dx plus v du by dy plus w du by dz. Everything has this delta x, delta y, delta z. So, we are divided through, therefore, it is per unit volume basis. Now, one question I have, what is this term, sorry, what is this term physically mean? What is this term and what is this term? I have four terms. One is rho du by dt, other is u du by dx, v du by dy, w du by dz. What are these terms? Who said convective acceleration? Somebody said. So, u times du by dx plus v times du by dy plus w times du by dz. If you just go back to your conservation of mass equation, the concept of material derivative was introduced here. If you look at the d rho terms, so transport of density because of the x component of the velocity, y component and the z component of the velocity. So these first four terms became capital D by dt of rho. Same thing, this will be your material derivative of the x component of the velocity du by dt. Is this clear? Any questions? If this is clear, then y and z are the same, we are not going to, okay. Now left hand side is taken care of, okay. Right hand side, summation of the forces. What is summation of the forces? What are the forces? So for that we have to write the force balance properly, we have to do with the appropriate sign, okay. So this convention again is can get confusing to the students, so we have to emphasize this again. This sigma xx, sigma xy and sigma xz, first subscript denotes the direction of the normal to the plane on which the stress acts. First subscript x, x, x here, that denotes the direction of the normal. So for this left face, the normal is in this direction, which is the x, x coordinate direction. So that is why the first subscript is x, and this is corresponding to the second subscript, direction of the stress. Therefore, this is a stress in the x direction, this is the sigma in the y direction, this is the sigma in the z direction, acting on a surface whose normal is in the x direction, okay. So every phase has this. So we have 18 such arrows which will have to be drawn, okay. All we are saying is each surface is having three stress components. Just to make life easy, we are saying the first subscript represents the surface for first subscript represents the normal direction to the plane on which the stress acts. The second subscript denotes the direction of that particular stress, okay. And the same convention will be followed for the others also. So what we are saying is, if this is the cuboid again, we have sigma xx, sigma yx and z, sigma zx, I think it is, we have not put it on the, okay, anyway, yeah, it becomes messy. So which of these is the normal stress, which is the shear stress? Color, color. What is P delta y delta z? How many say that is normal force? It is a pressure force, okay. So pressure is compressive. So pressure acting on the left surface is P times area, and the corresponding term on the right face will be the Taylor series expansion of that. Normal stress acting on the left surface, sigma xx times the area associated with that surface. On the right hand side, again it will be in the outward normal direction, sigma xx dA plus the first order term. What is this violet color arrow here? Shear. Sigma yx. Why am I doing, in the previous diagram, I have shown sigma xz, sigma xy, sigma yz, yy, xz, xy. What happened to all those terms? X momentum equation. So we are concerned with the balance of forces only in the x direction. So of these 9 which are here, this one, and this one are the ones which are acting in the x direction. So, we are taking that only. So, this purple arrow is representing the shear stress in the direction like this. Okay. So, sigma yx dx dz. Why is the direction this way? Opposing? We are writing for a velocity in the positive x direction. This is going to be in the opposite direction. So, sigma yx, that is the shear stress on this surface times the area associated with that surface and the corresponding Taylor series expansion of that. Okay. Why is it not in this direction on top? Why is the arrow direction reversed? In all these, this is outward, this is outward, this is inward, pressure is inward. Whereas here, this is left direction, this is right direction. All this I have had a student, terrible time. What is the reason?
You go to the name, no? You go to the name, shear. So you ask yourself, when does
what is shear?
Maintaining shear.
This motion. It is when it is shear, right? Scissor, what does it do? It is the opposite motion, correct? So, shearing is essentially tearing apart like this. So, that is what this force is. Okay. Yes. Acting on that solid surface, on that fluid surface, sorry. So, when I do the balance of these forces, I will get dP by dx will come with a negative sign because it is in the negative x direction plus sigma xx which corresponds to the normal stress, sigma yx which corresponds to the shear stress on this plane. There will be a sigma zx which will correspond to the shear stress on the front and the back surface, and then there will be a body force which would have to be multiplied by delta x, delta y, delta z, because body force per unit volume times the total volume of the cuboid. So, we take everything divide through by delta x, delta y, delta z. Yeah. A function f of x plus h is equal to, what does calculus tell me? That is definition of limit. We can write here, it is what he told. Okay. So, that is the first term of the Taylor series expansion, and that we are using right from mass conservation. We have used this even in differential equation for heat diffusion. Okay. So, when I do the balance, I am left with the left hand side which is rho du by dt, which is the material derivative, and the right hand side which is nothing but these things. So, everything has dx, dy, dz, which gets cancelled off. This is called as a Cauchy's equation.
Okay. Can you physically explain, how do I explain body forces? Pressure force normal. Now, these forces we understood reasonably well because we can feel the stresses because we know that they are gradients. But how do I understand body forces? One is gravity. Okay. That is because of which centrifugal force you get. Yes. Electromagnetic force, Coriolis force. What is Coriolis force?
What is Coriolis force? Especially for a fluid particle,
linear and angular motion force.
Yes. The fluid particle is having linear motion and also rotating. For example, if I have a pipe in which flow is taking place like this, at the same time this pipe is rotating. So there is a linear motion and at the same time rotary motion. So the fluid particle, whichever is there here, it is going to have what is this called right hand thumb rule. So this is the flow direction, this is the Coriolis, this is the direction of rotation, this is the Coriolis acceleration, Coriolis force will be in the opposite direction. Okay, so when this body force is there, all our things are going to go haywire. So whatever friction factor, everything what we have derived,
they are all for no body force. You take one of the body forces, it will be one PhD. it will be 1 PhD for any configuration, because everything will change. If you just take Coriolis force, friction factor will change, heat transfer coefficient will change. If you take centrifugal force, everything will change. If you take electromagnetic force the way he said, that's a PhD by itself. Okay, you just take one and its influence is significantly different. I mean, its influence is significantly high, which is what makes my velocity distribution, pressure distribution, and my integral parameters, friction factor, and if I take temperature, energy equation, everything subsequently will change. So that's what we need to understand. So body force, generally we are not taking when we are deriving in our regular thing, but if we take, every complete nature of the problem will change. That's true. Body force by definition is per unit to volume. Per unit to volume.
Which one? There is an error there. Both are enters.
Exit.
Exit. One is one.
Was that the rate at which the last one is exit? Rate of increase. Minus rate at which it enters, plus rate at which it exits. Yes. I will correct.
And actually, I don't think it matters, because it is a budget.
Budgeting. See, we are getting back to our E dot in.
If I put E out and E in, still the equation is valid.
That's what Professor was saying.
It is a convention. Q coming in thermodynamics, the people have broken their heads over this. Q coming in is positive, Q going out is positive. How does it matter? If you follow the same convention throughout in a given problem, you will always be right. Within the problem, don't change the convention, that's all.
Okay, so now what are we doing? Complete thing is over. We have to just substitute for sigma xx, sigma xy, sigma xz. We have to substitute the terms. They are all in terms of velocity gradient. Yes, here I am stating without deriving, especially normal stresses. Shear stresses, at least I think I can feel what it is, but this derivation is again a lengthy one, which we don't intend to do it at all here. But basically one thing I can tell, how we arrive at these equations. What we do here is we assume that stresses are proportional to strains, stresses are proportional to strains, and we get set of equations. If we solve those equations, I will get stress in terms of strain. What is del u by del x? That is a strain, that is a normal strain. What is a del u by del y? That is a shear strain. So if I take stresses as proportional to strains, then I will be able to relate my stresses, that is sigma xx, sigma xy, sigma xz, in terms of gradients. Okay, I am not deriving consciously, I am well aware of that. That will be again 3 to 4 transparencies. I don't intend to do that, but this I need to keep in the back of my mind, that stresses are proportional to strain I am taking and going ahead. Okay, fine. Is that the right way of doing? That's how I introduce viscosity. No, how is viscosity introduced? That is how I introduce, you know. So that is basically, so this I can easily do for Newtonian fluid. So stresses are proportional to strains, so I get these values for normal stress, shear stress, and again shear stress. I substitute that. What was this? Sigma xx, sigma xy, sigma xz. I substitute that. If I expand that, I will be getting rho du dt minus del p del x plus mu del squared u. Okay, plus del by del x of mu by 3 del dot v plus fx. What is this equation called? Or all put together, what are these three equations called? Navier-Stokes equations. Okay, so we can write very nicely vectorial form, although I don't like vectorial or tensorial. I would like to expand it so that I can feel each term easily. Okay, so but then people try to write that in vectorial form. This is vectorial form, but all that I want to emphasize here is these were the equations
how many equations I have and how many unknowns I have. These were found by Navier and Stokes independently, Navier from France and Stokes from England. So they found independently these equations, that is why we tend to call them as Navier Stokes equations. How many unknowns are there and how many equations are? But then only problem is that I cannot get closed form solutions all the time. Why? Why can I not get the closed form solutions that easily? For few restricted cases, for flow through a pipe, fully developed flow, flow between two parallel plates, all that we can get closed form solutions. Why not generally I solve once and keep it and use it for any situation? Because my equation is non-linear. My equations are non-linear, so they are not mathematically tractable. They are not mathematically tractable. That's what makes my life difficult. Okay. So with this, I think we are through with momentum equation. But now what I would do is, instead of starting energy equation, I will spend time on morning what professor broached up, that is turbulence. We left one question, if you remember, rho u prime v prime. Now that we have Navier-Stokes equation in our hand, I am going to go to, this is my fluid mechanics notes, so I have not put this yet. Now that in the morning discussion it was logically leading to that, so I thought it's okay that we thought that we should introduce you this. So now, how did we handle turbulence? Someone said random. The moment the word random comes, which mathematics comes into picture? What is the recourse of maths? Which maths I take into account? Yes? Statistics. So I take recourse of statistics, and that is what I am doing here. So I take an average value u bar, and u prime is the velocity at any instant minus u bar. Okay. So now what is u bar? What is u bar? I am integrating it for some time t. Here in this case, I am starting from time t naught to t naught plus t. That is all the difference. Morning professor derived it for 0 to t. Here I am showing it between t naught to t naught plus t. But now, how do I decide this capital T? How do I decide this capital T? Can I take half a second? Now let us say I have an imaginary sensor. Hot wire anemometer is the typical sensor what we use for measuring velocity as a function of time. Mangesh has used this, he can feel it. You can discuss with him left and right in the guest house what is hot wire and all. You bug him and get to know what is hot wire. Hot wire is a small wire which is 5 times thinner than my hair diameter, 15 micrometer. I will try to keep that with a wire at a constant temperature, okay, and that wire is one arm of a Wheatstone bridge. Now when the flow takes place, what will happen to my temperature of the wire? It will dip. When it dips, again I will apply certain amount of power to bring it back to the same constant temperature which I had set earlier. So that measure of change of power is the measure of velocity. That is a very simplistic way of telling. Okay. So the point is, if I have such a thin wire whose thermal inertia is so less, you can understand what I mean by thermal inertia. What I mean by thermal inertia here? Rho v Cp is very less. So time constant, it can respond very fast. So then only I can get this velocity distribution. No, I am not going to take a question. I have not answered my question yet. So how long should I integrate this? That hot wire will give me the velocity as a function of time. How will I decide this capital T? 1 minute, because I can integrate for long time. Half a minute, 1 minute, 2 minutes, 3 minutes, 4 minutes, 5 minutes, 6 minutes. How do I decide while doing experiments? I will not allow Mangesh to answer. Others, anyone can answer. Should, professor said in the morning, should average velocity be a function of time? Should average velocity be a function of time? No, then that means whether I take 5 minutes, 6 minutes, 7 minutes, it should not matter. But if I take too short a time, my average velocity might be erroneous. I should take 5 minutes, 6 minutes, 7 minutes, 5th minute average velocity should be same as 6th minute, that should be same as 7th minute, that should be same as 8th minute. If they are different, I should integrate still longer duration. What is your question? Okay, that is not in the purview of this, but still, no. If you have a single wire, you cannot. If I have a wire, now this is my wire, let us say. This is my wire and flow is in this direction. It is going to measure velocity in this direction. Now, if I orient this in this direction, it will give me what? Y velocity. Similarly, if I orient normal to Z direction, I will get the Z velocity, but I need to orient all the time with single wire. But there are cross wires, there are triple wires, all sorts of things are there. Let us not get into that. Telling is easier than doing, okay, fine. So, but in principle, yes, we can do. Now, coming back, average velocity is this. Now, u is equal to u bar plus u prime. What is u prime now? U prime also, u prime bar, I am saying. U prime is u minus u bar. U prime bar, what will happen if I integrate this fluctuating component without doing statistics? Let us see this and see. Let us not have to do integration, we will do that integration anyways. But if I average only the fluctuating components for long time, what will happen? Sometimes it is plus, sometimes it is minus, sometimes it is plus, sometimes it is minus. What should happen? It should get cancelled out. So, ultimately I should be ending up with 0. That is what happens if I integrate that. You can go through this integration, u bar minus u bar, so u bar, so if you integrate this, you get again u bar and you get, yeah.
One analogy which I just was thinking how to tell this, you think of any of these prices of course everything is increasing now price, but you think of a stock price,
yeah,
the base price and then it fluctuates, okay. So, if you are a smart fellow, you will not sell it immediately, or you know, if you are a lazy fellow, you might just keep it for several years or months on end. At the end of the day, the net value will be the same as what you have purchased it at, by and large. Okay, I'm talking of normal thing. Of course, if you look at gold or something right now, it is always increasing. We are not taking such a case, but by and large, a stable thing with minor fluctuations up and down, integrated over a long period of time, it will average out to be the base value. So, these fluctuations essentially die out with time. It is not dying out, the magnitudes of the fluctuations are such that the positive and negative almost cancel off to give you almost zero value. That is what you can do.
Before I flash the next transparency, I am now going to ask you a question. Now, will my u prime, v prime bar, is it going to be 0? U prime, v prime bar. We now saw that little while ago, u prime bar is, it is not visible, no problem. This is a different prime, okay, sorry. So, u prime bar, we saw that this is 0. So, now will u prime, v prime bar be 0? What does u prime means? Fluctuating component in the x velocity. Now, similarly, as he asked, hot wire I will orient and measure the v velocity and get v prime. So, at every instant, I am going to get u prime and also v prime. If I multiply that and then average over a period of time, will it become 0? Need not be. It need not get 0. Okay. So, that is what is the, what is this? What was this? What is this? This was my, what did we tell in the morning? This is turbulent shear stress. See, physically also we can think like this. U prime is what? Random motion in the x direction. V prime is what? Random motion in the y direction. If I have both of them only, I can have some mixing happening. Some mixing happening, otherwise mixing cannot happen. Is that right? that is how physically I have to understand this minus rho u prime v prime. But you can always ask how on earth I should know that I should be defining these normal stresses and all that. It is like a religion. Professor Date's terms, we have one professor by name A.W. Date, with whom I have learnt all this. In fact, what y plus and all I taught you in the morning, it is so ingrained in my mind because of Professor Date, because he has learnt it from Spalding. That k epsilon model itself has come from Launder and Spalding, okay, the one which I was answering in the morning. So he taught us. So that is why it is so universal velocity profile, I do not have to remember at all, because he has taught us it so well, so well, because he has learnt it from the originator, Launder himself, Spalding himself, okay. So point is, this shear stress is because of u prime v prime. This is shear stress. Now normal stresses, if I take normal stresses again, u prime squared bar, u prime whole squared bar, can it become 0? U prime whole squared bar, u prime can be plus or minus, why am I squaring it? To make it non-zero, okay. So it cannot become 0 if I average. So this is minus rho u prime squared bar is my normal stress. So how do I understand this? I think this is all fine, I will leave it there. So we understood, no? We understood what is a normal stress. I mean, what will happen to my u prime if I average u prime for long time? What will happen? U prime, if I average for long time, it becomes 0. But u prime v prime bar, if I average, u prime v prime, if I average, it is non-zero. So similarly, if I average u prime squared for long time, it is non-zero, okay. Now let me take the Napier-Stokes equation, okay. And now what are we going to do is that, what did we do by telling, what did we do? In turbulent flow, we divided the flow into two domains. What was that? One was, no. That is why I wanted to tell, I have divided into two domains. One is mean motion, another one is fluctuating motion. It is like mean motion, on mean motion I have superimposed the fluctuating motion. So there are two motions occurring. So one is mean motion, another one is fluctuating motion, okay. Whatever I measure with the Pitot probe, what is it going to measure? Mean motion. U bar is it is going to capture, it cannot capture u prime, okay. So now let us take the momentum equation. Instead of taking continuity equation, we will just take the momentum equation. Now why do not you put the mean component and the fluctuating component for each term? Come on, I want all of you to derive, because many of you are sleeping. I want all of you to derive, because I cannot derive it, but I want you to derive. Come on, let us take the first term, that is, let us say del u, what is that? Yeah, before doing that, I have to do a small trick. I will take the x momentum equation left hand side, okay. Please write this in this form, that is, you have rho del u by del t plus u del u by del x plus v del u by del y plus w del u by del z. Let me rewrite this as del u squared by del x, is that okay? How is this equal to this? Can anyone tell me? How is the left hand side of the second equation same as the left hand side of the first equation? You expand this, na? What do I get? Continuity equation you will get if you expand that, and that will become 0, okay. Please, I have not put that here, because it becomes too lengthy if I go on putting. So that is why I have not put that. So you get this. Now you average this, you average the first term. Now you just take del of u squared bar, u squared upon del x. Now you do the Reynolds averaging, that is, what is this? I am going to put u squared, I have to replace u by u bar and u prime. For u, I am replacing, where is my, yeah, for u, I just said a little while ago that I am having two components, one is the mean motion, another one is the fluctuating component. So if I put u bar and u prime, and I have to square it, no, I have to square it. So if I square it and expand it, what do I get? Del u prime squared bar by del x plus del u bar squared by del x. Ha, what happened to my u prime u bar bar? That is, I get three terms, I have put two terms only. What happens to my u prime u bar bar? It is 0, it is 0. Can you see that? I think I have done that. Yeah, I have done that here. U prime u bar, if I expand that blindly, if I expand that, see u prime, that is u bar, I can pull out, na? Pull out of the integration, and I know that this integration is already 0. So u prime u bar bar has to be 0. Agreed? So now that is the reason I have only two terms. So that is del u prime squared bar by del x plus 2 u bar del u bar by del x. Now this is only for the first term. What am I doing? What am I doing? I am doing what is called as famously Reynolds averaging. Apparently Reynolds did it, so that is why it is called as Reynolds averaging. Okay. So similarly, let me just go ahead and do it for me. UV, the previous term was, next term is del UV by del y. If I do that, what will I get? U has to be replaced by u bar plus u prime. Next one is v bar plus v prime. If I take the product of that, u bar, u prime bar, u bar, v prime bar, what should happen to that? 0. Similarly, v prime, v bar, u prime bar also has to become 0. So I end up with only two terms. You see here, I had one term extra, and here I am getting one term extra, because u bar v bar anyway is there. So u v bar I get. Similarly, I can do it for del u v bar. So you get u bar del u bar by del z plus w bar del u bar by del z plus del u prime w prime by del z. Is that okay? Are you all with me? Okay. Now let me do it for pressure. Same thing for pressure. Pressure is, I have to replace it by p bar plus p prime. P prime bar has to, p prime bar has to vanish. So I get only del p bar by del x. So if I write complete equation, what I wrote earlier, I have u prime bar squared by del x, 2 u bar by del x plus u bar del v bar by del y plus v bar del u bar by del y. This is the additional term and this is the additional term. Is that okay? Yeah. Which one? So p prime bar is getting 0. No problem. First time when you are doing it will happen. So when I rearrange that, I am coming back to my momentum equation. What were we doing? To remind you, this was my momentum equation. I was trying to replace each term with mean motion component and the fluctuating component. So that is what is called Reynolds averaging. When I do that, I get, you see, what is that I get? If you just see only this, what are these three terms? They are what? No. They are what? First three terms, left hand side, del p bar by del x and this. They look similar to my old momentum equation, but this is representing mean motion. Mean motion. You see, every term is having what? What is called? Bar. Now you see on the right hand side with minus rho, what are the other additional terms which are there, which were not there earlier? Fluctuating terms. Those are what are called as Reynolds stresses. Okay. So the first term, this is contributing for the normal stresses, this is contributing for the shear stress, and this is also contributing for the shear stress. This was done for which equation? X momentum equation. I can do similarly for y and z. Now you see when I do that, here in u and v, let us take x as this, y as this, z as this. So u v means it is going to be u prime in this direction and v prime in this direction. So mixing in this plane. You are getting? So u w means this plane. So u prime is in this plane, in this direction, and w prime is in this. So that is mixing in this direction. See, it's so physically it's very easy to see if I imagine this picture. U prime v prime means mixing has to occur in this plane. U prime w prime means mixing has to occur in this plane. Is that okay? So that's how you can imagine now v prime, w prime, v prime, u prime, all sorts of combinations you can. Yes. Now if I put this in complete x, y and z, completely if I do that, what are the additional stresses I get? These are what? First three terms in all of these equations are what? Navier-Stokes equations applied for mean flow. Additional terms which are coming is are sigma xx prime, tau xy prime, that is minus rho u prime squared, minus rho u prime v prime, minus rho u prime v prime w prime bar. Okay, I am not going to answer you one question now, but I am going to ask you. None of you asked me, which I was waiting that you will ask me, but none of you asked. Why I write always minus rho u prime v prime? Does that mean that it is negative sign? Tau wall, I wrote today morning, tau laminar plus tau turbulent. And I wrote for tau laminar it is mu del u by del y plus tau turbulent is minus rho u prime v prime. Does that make my shear stress negative compared to laminar? I am not going to answer this question. Please cook this in your minds overnight and give me the answer tomorrow morning. Okay, you can check Wikipedia, whatever, whatever, no problems. But if you, as long as you can come up with the answer, you come up, it doesn't matter. Okay. So these three are normal stresses in x, y and z direction, and these are additional shear stresses in x, y, z direction. Is that okay? Yeah. So these are called Reynolds stresses. So now you see, already in laminar flow my life was so difficult. For laminar flow I had 4 equations, 4 unknowns, at least number of unknowns were equal to number of equations. So but then we said okay, we cannot solve it because it is non-linear. But now I have same number of equations, but number of unknowns have gone terribly high. So rho u prime squared, v prime squared, w prime, they are all very high. How do I solve this? No solution. You have to measure them. Morning professor was saying, how do I get them, these shear stresses, these fluctuating components, how do I get them? No way. I will have to measure them and use in the form of models. That is what has been done in K epsilon turbulence model, and that is why it does not work for all class of problems. Some reason for flat plate and internal flows, these stresses have a definite pattern. So if I have to come up with a turbulence model properly for a impinging flows, I have to take proper these measured stresses. Is that okay? That is the only way I can get closure in my problem. What do I mean by closure? Number of equations should be equal to number of unknowns. The unknowns are additional. How many I have got into? 6. 6 unknown stresses. I have to, only way out is I have to take hot wire anemometer or laser Doppler velocimetry or particle image velocimetry and measure. So that is why I keep saying experiments and numerical work go together. They are not separate. They are complementary to each other. So they have to complement. One has to feed to other. Okay, fine. So this was done, what we are studying today and trying to understand today was done more than a century back. Okay, we are studying nothing, absolutely nothing new. There is a saying also, if you want a new idea, read an old book. It only means that there is nothing new in this world. Everything someone has thought, it is just that we are trying to understand again. Okay. Anyway, so this is Reynolds stresses. In 1895, Reynolds has done all this. Okay. I think that is what we went up to, laminar shear stress, turbulent shear stress, and that is how we got into this viscous layer, overlap layer and all that. Is that okay? Okay. I think that is about turbulent stresses. So, coming back now, okay. So, now, okay, before doing the non-dimensionalization, now I have written, if I take a flow over a flat plate, what is my conservation of mass equation? Let us write. I want all of you to write along with me. So, what is my momentum equation? Yes, you can flip your pages, we have derived in the morning, just before lunch. D rho by dt plus rho of del dot v, that is del u by del x plus del v by del y plus del w by del z is equal to 0. What does this mean? What does this fellow mean to us? What does this physically mean? Stretching in x direction, stretching in y direction, stretching in z direction. This is dilation, volumetric dilation. It is getting swollen or maybe compression, but people call it as volumetric dilation. If it is incompressible, it cannot dilate, it cannot expand. Okay. So, only it can dilate when it is compressible, that is what it means. So, nice, is not it? So, now let us take momentum equation. What is my momentum, x momentum equation? Rho, come on, one of you should tell, I will have to catch someone to ask. Yes, du by dt, this is total derivative, remember, equal to minus del p by del x plus mu del squared u by del x squared plus del squared u by del y squared plus del squared u by del z squared plus mu by 3, is that right? Mu by 3 del of, let me go back, I cannot also remember. Del by del x of, it is there, del by del x of, if I assume properties are constant, I can pull this mu by 3 out, but let us not do that. Del by del x of mu by 3 into del dot v. Del dot v, I do not think I need to expand that, because I can write this as del dot v, so that you know what it is, del dot v plus f x equal to 0. What is this? X momentum equation. So, similarly, let me write for y momentum equation, no problem. So, d by dt is equal to minus del p by del y plus mu into del squared u by del squared, del squared v by del x squared plus del squared v by del y squared plus del squared v by del z squared plus del by del y of mu by 3 del dot v plus f y is equal to 0. Now, is that okay? No, I have not told, 0 is not right. Oh, sorry. You see, I am also sleeping. Okay. So it is not 0, it has to be, it has no meaning if I write it as 0, absolute nonsense. Okay. So, now if I take my fluid as incompressible, what will happen? What all terms will vanish? What will this equation reduce to? Del dot v is equal to 0, is that right? Now, what will this equation reduce to? Let us say there are no body forces. This term is 0 because del dot v is 0 and this term is 0 and I am neglecting this. Is that okay? And if it is steady flow, what will happen to this term? I will be left out with u del u by del x plus v del u by del y plus w del u by del z. I will ask you a question. Let us say I say that viscosity is 0. When do I say that viscosity is 0? Inviscid flow, okay, ideal flow where there is no viscosity. So what will happen to my equation? What is that equation? I do not know whether I have kept it here or not, but anyway, what is that equation? Yeah, what is that equation? What is
much used,
abused, whatever, yeah. This Euler's equation you will get, because that is how historically hydrodynamics came into picture, where viscosity was not considered. That is why D. Alembert's paradox. What is D. Alembert's paradox? D. Alembert suffered from this paradox, that is why it is called D. Alembert's paradox. D. Alembert tried to calculate force around a cylinder. What is the net pressure force around a cylinder? Pressure, net force around a cylinder, he got 0 all the time he calculates, he gets 0. But he knows that there is some resistance, because viscous, some, if not viscosity was not defined that time, he knew that there is a resistance for the flow, but he is getting 0. So that is why it is called as D. Alembert's paradox, because in his derivation always he neglected viscosity, okay. So now this equation, if I neglect viscosity, I will get Euler's equation, which can be reduced to Bernoulli's equation, okay. So this is, in fact, we can introduce back, we can relate in the class, we can relate if you are teaching fluid mechanics, you can relate back to Euler's and Bernoulli's equation from this, okay. So I think we will stop here, it is time that we stop here. I think I will not even go to non-dimensionalization, because it was good that we took a recap. So, but one thing, as a teacher, I would believe that as a teacher, I should be able to write continuity equation, momentum equation, energy equation in the middle of the night if I am woken up also.
And identify the terms. In fact, we always ask, identify
yeah.
What each
term. Now let us ask ourselves now before we wind up. We have 3 more minutes. That is a good question. How do I feel each of these terms? Here I did. d rho by dt means what? Density variation with time and space, because by virtue of velocity, Now similarly, what is this? This is coming from pressure force. You go to its mother, who is the originator? This is the pressure force. What about this? You can call diffusion term, but this is actually viscous forces. When I take viscid flow, inviscid flow, I make it as 0. So what are these terms? Yeah, but if I have to write Reynolds number, in Reynolds number I always use one force upon another force, inertia force by viscous force, inertia upon viscous force. So what is this? Inertia force, mass into acceleration, no? So it is inertia force. What was this? This was mass into acceleration, no? It is mass into acceleration. So we should be able to see the picture, what each equation is. In fact, if I have to recollect, surely I am joking in Feynman. You know Feynman? Feynman was the scientist who got Nobel Prize on something, I do not know on what he got. But he was involved in diagnosing why Challenger shuttle failed, okay. What he tells in that is, each term I should be imagining as a picture, he tells. So that is what everyone says, you know, if I can think through pictures, I have understood that. Yeah,
Actually, fluid mechanics is a wonderfully visual subject. Unfortunately, it is taught in such a boring way that the whole beauty of the subject is lost. In fact, I had the opportunity to take compressible flow, that is where you have density changes, gas dynamics, under one very famous person who had so many pictures in his lectures. Every lecture would have some 5 to 6 pictures, and it was probably the most enjoyable course. And doing compressible fluid mechanics, through the pictures, lot of this incompressible fluid mechanics became clear. Actually, I mean, at that point, oh, this is like this. How foolish we are, we could not understand. We could not understand because there was no feel for those terms. Mm. So, we should try to make it as visual as possible. And unfortunately, we are behind completing the syllabus, getting the exam in time, this, that, that. But it is just teaching. We are not educating.
Yeah. You had some question. How do I feel it? Total acceleration, all that I can say, it is having both convective term and the transient term. I do not think I can tell anything other than that. Inertia, I understand always everyone has inertia. Now we have inertia to get up to go to coffee. So we have inertia in the morning to get up. So that is how fluid particle is also having inertia to move. So that is what is this inertial term. I think every term has, I mean, it is having a meaning. Okay. So I think here we will stop and get started tomorrow morning. But I want you fresh in the morning, because we are going to start on a fresh note the energy equation, okay, which is going to be involved than what we have derived so far.
Things which you have not seen.